cruise over in Europe somewhere, or a trip down the Pacific Coast Highway. But what I'm talking about might be considered an immersion experience, where you are so embedded in your surroundings and culture, and so steeped in that culture and surroundings that they literally become part of who you are. They infuse you. Outward practice as well as an interior reality.
It has an inward aspect to it. Foster says the Christian discipline of simplicity is an inward reality that results in an outward lifestyle. Both parts are essential. You've got to have both, he says. He goes on to say that we deceive ourselves if we believe we can possess the inward reality and not have it affect our outward lifestyle. To attempt to arrange a lifestyle outwardly of simplicity without the inward reality leads to deadly legalism. And that's what I was doing, cultivating the outward lifestyle without the inward reality. Now, Jesus had plenty to say about living a life of simplicity, a life unencumbered by a desire for more, freedom from being weighed down by stuff. Today's scripture is just one of many. Thank you, Susan, for the reading. For example, do not worry about your life, for life is more than food, and the body is more than clothing. Consider the lilies of the field. They neither toil nor spin. Sell all that you own and distribute the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. Notice the rich man in today's scripture. He was wealthy, and in biblical times, wealth was considered a sign of God's favor or God's blessing. His land produced abundantly. He had more than enough. He had more than enough for him and his family. He more than likely had enough to supply his friends and neighbors and maybe the whole community. In fact, he lived a very lavish lifestyle, probably according to the standards of his times. Remember that TV show, Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous? He probably could have been the star on Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous. He might have even owned an ostrich jacket. Certainly not the definition of simplicity. Notice the rich man's self-centeredness. My crops, my barns, my grain, my goods, my soul, my. And although his wealth may have indicated God's blessing, there was no indication of his willingness to share any of it. He was really possessed by his possessions. In this parable, we're allowed to overhear the rich man's inner thoughts, even to gain access into the inclination of his heart. We see that inwardly, perhaps, he was anxious. He was worried. He was doubtful. He was fearful. He says to himself, "What should I do with all my stuff? I know, I'll tear down my barns and I'll build even bigger ones to store my grain and all my goods." In his anxiety, he hoarded his grains and goods, thinking having all this stuff would enable him to relax. In his anxiety, he had to plot and plan and scheme. He probably lay awake at night wondering and worrying, "What am I going to do with all this stuff?" All that plotting and planning and scheming is a form of duplicity, ways that we deceive ourselves and other people. Duplicity, the opposite of simplicity. That duplicity kept his inner life in turmoil and not at peace. How unlike the folks that Psalm 1 speaks of. Happy are those who delight in the law of the Lord, who are open to God's instruction, who meditate on it day and night. Happy are those whose focus is on the kingdom of God, who are single-minded and not distracted by the lure of things. Their roots go deep. They are nourished through prayer and in silence, in solitude, in contemplation. Meditating on God's instruction enables them to trust God and to entrust their lives to God. These persons have a resource for sustaining their lives under any circumstance. The scripture says that in all they do, they will succeed. And we're not talking about material success here. The psalmist is talking about those people having their lives nourished and sustained through their communion with God. That's a form of interior simplicity. So the practice of simplicity is not just about adopting a frugal lifestyle. As one who was raised by parents who grew up in the Depression, it's not about not having anything. It's not about being an ascetic and dying and denying oneself the goodness of God's gifts. Those gifts aren't given to us to freely enjoy. Richard Foster says that simplicity sets us free to receive the provision of God as a gift that is not ours to keep, and that can be freely shared with others. Simplicity has the inner aspect of placing ourselves unreservedly in the arms and the trust of God, and that manifests itself in an outward lifestyle of simplicity and detachment from things. You might say simplicity of heart and life. A friend and I drove across country a couple weeks ago to the North Carolina coast. We stayed in a historic old bed and breakfast built in 1805. Very old, antique, beautiful place. It was owned by a man named Craig. For me, Craig was the embodiment of the practice of simplicity. He sat down as we were eating breakfast, and he'd been cooking in the kitchen, and he came in and started talking to us and told us his very life story. He'd owned a heavy equipment company in Hampton, Virginia. He eventually sold the company to an English firm, and after the sale of the company, he bought a pawn shop. After he opened his pawn shop, shortly thereafter, homeless veterans started coming around. As time went by, more and more homeless vets would show up in the pawn shop. So he decided to start serving breakfast to them. This is a true story. So he's serving breakfast to the homeless vets, and more are coming. So what do you do? He starts serving breakfast and lunch to the homeless vets. And then he started taking them to the hospital when they got sick, and buying their medication when they needed medications because they couldn't afford, they didn't have insurance. Occasionally, he would sit with them as they lay dying. At one time in his life, he took in two orphan boys that played on his son's Little League teams and raised those boys as his own by himself. And then Craig starts talking about forgiveness and the cross. And he said, when he got his vertical relationship right, the horizontal relationship was so much easier. All this from a man named Craig. He was, for me, a living demonstration of the practice of simplicity, an inward reality that results in an outward lifestyle of freedom and generosity. May it be so for you and for me. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As the ushers come forward, we will now receive our tithes and offerings.